Okay. Good morning, Dr. Raj. Welcome to our special class.
Good morning.
Invited lecture. I hope students will come. Students will join us. Already we have a few right from this browser, not from directly from Facebook. Okay.
Okay.
I want to introduce you to your viewers. Let me see. Okay, we have many viewers, increasing number of viewers, a very good sign. Okay, now let me introduce to you our guest, Dr. Prayer M.O. Raj. Dr. Prayer M.O. Raj is assistant professor in PG and Research Department of English, Pachapas College, Chennai. His recent works are Shakespeare and Critical Theory, Paper, Pen and Ink, Postcolonial and Textual Politics, and Contested Histories and Politics of People, Theorizing Subalternity, that is forthcoming book. His research interests include literary critical theory and alternative epistemologies. Now, besides, I want to tell our viewers that Dr. Raj has also been associated with our college. Indirectly, though, right from 2013, he published an article on Giorgio Agamben for our animal issue. We published a special issue on animal studies, and he contributed a paper. So our association is very long and is very strong. Now, I will hand over the session to Dr. Raj, and you can start now. I am going off the screen. Okay, you can start it.
Thank you, Tarun. First of all, I want to thank Tarun for making this possible. It all happened in a very short arrangement. And thank you for inviting me and having me here. Today, we'll be discussing a very important essay by Stuart Hall, Cultural Identity and Diaspora. This essay actually has three parts. You all know, you might have heard about Stuart Hall. He is a very important cultural theorist, born in Jamaica. He is often considered as the godfather of multiculturalism. This essay is a very important essay. Not only important, it is a very good essay to read for the topic cultural identity. As I said, it is a very meticulously written essay. There are a lot of things that we can learn. There are a lot of things that we can, lot of critical tools that we can get out of this essay. To start with, I want to introduce few terms that you might find in this essay. One is diaspora, the other is representation. The other is cultural identity. The term difference from Derrida. The term enunciation, theory of positions. These are all important terms that he will be discussing in this essay. As he begins the essay, he talks about the emerging third cinema in the Caribbean, Caribbean vicinity. What is this third cinema? Usually when we hear third cinema, we'll be curious to know what is the first and second. The first cinema is the Hollywood cinema, the epic center of filmmaking. The second is the European art house cinema. And the third is what Stuart Hall is speaking about, is a cinema that presents the experience of people who encountered colonial and post-colonial forces. The colonial and imperial forces actually completely altered the cultural, social, political sphere of this people. So he's going to talk about how cultural identity has to be represented and how is cultural identity represented in this new cinema, that is the third cinema. For our convenience, we can also name it as third world cinema. We can all associate with the cinema. Now, the question here is, who is the subject of the cinema? The answer is the blacks of the diaspora. So this is the key question that he will be discussing. The subject of this third cinema is the blacks of the diaspora. The second question that he raises is from what position the subject is speaking. Now, in the post-colonial theory and other area studies, there are a lot number of theories of position. For example, you have a theory of enunciation by Homi Bhabha in his book, Location of Culture. He talks about a space, a hybrid space or an ambivalent space, a third space from where a colonial subject can talk. So from these positions, we learned that there are three things that are very important for a subject to speak. His question from what position a subject speaks represents the cultural identity. There are three things that Stuart Hall says. One, when we talk of position of a subject, we should think about, is the subject speaking in his or her name? Two, is the subject speaking for himself or herself? And third, is a subject speaking out his or her own experience? Now, this position of speech, or this is position of articulation, this position of enunciation will tell you the cultural identity of a person or a character or a subject or a post-colonial subject or a diasporic subject. So this position is very complex. This is not very easy to understand. Why? Because when I speak for myself, I speak my experience, I am unique. When you speak, you become a unique subject. From this point of view, therefore, cultural identity or identity itself is not very stable. It is not a very identical entity. It is an evolving process. You have a cultural identity, I have a cultural identity, our neighborhood have a cultural identity. We all have different positions of articulation. Therefore, when we think of cultural identity, we think of a process. It is not a stable identity that we are talking about. So from this point of view, he is going to talk two important things in this essay. How do we think about cultural identity? For Stuart Hall, there are two ways of thinking about cultural identity. The first one is to think about cultural identity as a collective self, as a stable reference point, a point of reference, what he calls a collective self, a collective culture, a collective history, a collective cultural codes that we share. If I give a very pertinent example or a very simple example that we might understand, for example, if you think of the period of freedom struggle in India, maybe from 1940s to 1947, we represented a collective self. We represented a collective politics of struggle. We represented a collective cultural code that actually pushed towards only one aim, that is towards freedom. Similarly, the blacks of the diaspora also have collective identity, collective culture, or collective self that becomes the stable point of their reference. So this is the first way of looking at cultural identity. The first way of looking at cultural identity is to see a collective culture, a collective identity. The examples that he gives is one of negritude. In 1930s and 40s and 50s, you see writers, diasporic writers, people from Africa, people from Caribbean who were in France, actually started a movement of writing against the imperial forces. So they all shared a collective culture. Now, what is important about this cultural identity or this collective self? Actually, if you examine a particular subject in relation to collective identity, we'll be able to bring out at least three or four things, what according to Stuart Hall. The first is collective culture or a collective history. When we talk about collective self, it will be easy for us to recollect or retell, re-articulate our past. The second thing is when we talk about a collective self, we can reunite. There is a process of reunifications of culture, reunification of history, reunification of politics that actually can bind us together. The third aspect of thinking about cultural identity as a collective self is that we realize that our culture, our identity is, our collective identity is very resourceful. There is a lot to talk about the collective culture of the blacks of the diaspora. There is a rich culture, for example, folk culture, folk religion, we can talk about. The fourth thing that he tells is that when we talk about a collective identity, it is easy to resist the forces or the imposition of power upon a particular group or a particular collective. So this is what is the first way of thinking about cultural identity. The second way of thinking about cultural identity is a little difficult for a first-time reader. He uses post-structuralism to explain what the second type of second way of thinking about cultural identity. If the first way of thinking about cultural identity is about collectivity, the second way of thinking about cultural identity is about difference. Now, as I said, identity is not identical. Cultural identity is a process. Identity is a process. We'll be constantly evolving. Actually, we evolve from within. Though there are a lot of forces that can influence our cultural identity, identity is something that is constituted from within. So he introduces two terms. What makes cultural identity different, of a person different from the other, is there are two things. One is what we really are, our being. What I am, what I am is not what you are. So what we really are is different from what others are. The second thing is what we really become, becoming. What I really become is not what you really become. So in this way, even though we have a collective self, collective identity, our identities are different. So the being and becoming, who you are, who I am, what we become is different from each person. Therefore, this tells us there is a uniqueness in examining or representing or positioning the cultural identity. For that, he brings in a couple of other substantiation for his theory. One is how power is actually influencing this difference. He talks about a famous couplet from Foucault. When Foucault introduces a couplet, power / knowledge. The simple way of understanding is that where there is power, there is knowledge. So if you want to execute your power, enforce your power upon someone, you should know someone. So you know someone and then you enforce your power. This is what happened in colonialism. And if you read the classic Edward Sayre, which Stuart Hall also talks about, he introduced a process called othering, knowing the subject. This is in simple terms, knowing the subject to other, distance yourself. So to enforce power, you actually are othering. This knowledge of the subject is very important in constructing a collective identity or a cultural identity. Therefore, what we learn out of this is that every subject or subjected to some kind of knowing or othering, and that involves power. The second thing that he says is cultural identity is not a fixed essence. We don't have a fixed essence. That is what I earlier told. We are being and we are becoming. This is a constant process. Now, what is very important in Stuart Hall's concept of difference is his allusion from Derrida. He introduces a Derridean term, difference. You all know this is a little bit of a difficult term to understand. What is difference? difference is not just difference. D-I-F-F-E-R-E-N-C is difference. But difference is D-I-F-F-E-R-A-N-C. There are two parallel thoughts that go within this concept difference. One is difference is differing a meaning and deferring a meaning. I'll give you a very simple example. Before that, I want to tell you that this is a counter concept to structuralism. Saussurean structuralism put forward an idea that the meaning that we make, the process of signification, happens through difference. The meaning differs. For example, when you ask, what is an orange? If you are Ferdinand de Saussure or if you are a structuralist, you would tell me that that which is not an apple is an orange. This is the difference. You are making a meaning out of difference. Now, if you ask Derrida, he is adding one more open-ended idea. That is, it is not only that which is not orange is an apple. We can also explain that if orange has a fleshy inside, then it could become orange. Now, see, he is extending the meaning. He is deferring the meaning. He is postponing the meaning. He is widening the meaning. So in a meaning-making process, there is no one stable, fixed way of making meaning. Another example is that if I read Hamlet, I can read Hamlet from one perspective. If you read Hamlet, you also can read it from another perspective. I can read it from Hamlet's perspective. You can read it from Ophelia's perspective, or you can read it from Polonius's perspective. Now, all these different ways of meaning making happens without tampering the original meaning. That is key to Derrida's understanding of difference. How is this connected to cultural identity? Cultural identity is a process of difference. There are three things that Stuart Hall is telling about difference. One, we should understand that, like meaning, representation of cultural identity or presentation of cultural identity is not stable. Two, it doesn't have a boundary. It is extended. Every time you present your cultural identity, every time your cultural identity is represented, the boundaries are reset, in his words. It is reset. It is extended. So our cultural identity, remember what I said earlier, being and becoming. This is a process. So when being and becoming happens for a cultural subject, his identity is actually extended every time. The third thing is that identity, there are a lot of things that actually supplements, contributes to this identity, like meaning. So when you supplement an identity, the vision of your cultural identity get extended. Now, to think about the difference between cultural identity and as a collective self and cultural identity as difference. Now you know the difference. Cultural identity as a collective self is a point of reference, but cultural identity as difference is ever extending. It is a process. It is constantly evolving. Now, these are the two ways of looking at the cultural identity. The last part of the essay, he talks about how cultural identity can be represented in the new cinema, the third cinema. For that, he talks about three presences. The first presence that he talks about is an African presence. This African presence is the presence of the past. For example, if you talk about blacks of the diaspora, you have a history of the past. That is, you go back to slavery, the transportation. These are the things that is always there in the history, in the culture, in the politics, in the way they present themselves as a cultural identity. It is always there. It is an unseen presence of the blacks of the diaspora. So this is something that is already there. This is the first way of presenting, or this is the first presence that you see in a cultural identity. The second presence is European presence. The European presence is the presence of power, the presence of imposition, enforcement of power. Obviously, the European presence denotes the colonial and the imperial era, where power is enforced upon a subject, and how it has altered the being and becoming of a subject. So this is always a hostile, this is always a violent, aggressive presence that we see in cultural identity. Now the third presence that he uses two terms. One is the African presence or the New World presence. The African presence or the New World presence is the presence of not power, it is a presence of assimilation. We see lot of cultures, lot of trajectories of cultures come together. This is actually a meeting point. This is a confluence. They're all the politics, the language, the culture is now shared. We meet strangers, we meet people from other culture, and our identity is constantly stable. Two examples that he gives. One is the creolization. How we have our own mother tongue, and then we tend to learn English, and then we mix it up, the process of assimilation. Another example that we might have is the culture. We have our own indigenous cultures, and then we borrow cultures from other important cultures, other cultures that intervene us, intersect us, and then our cultural identity is constantly in the process of becoming. So this makes cultural identity a constant production and reproduction. So every time you think about a subject's cultural identity, you think about production and reproduction of cultural identity. So it is in a constant evolving process. Most of the time it is constituted from within. To summarize whatever I said, cultural identity and diaspora talks about a lot of metaphors or a lot of concepts, a lot of ideas, which explains to us how cultural identity can be presented, how cultural identity can be represented. He starts with how the question, who is the subject of third cinema? He identifies that the subject of this cinema is the blacks of the diaspora. Then he talks about from what position cultural identity is being presented. And there are two ways of thinking about cultural identity. The one is cultural identity as a collective self. And the second is collective identity as difference. And then he presents three presents, or he gives us three different ways of how to present this cultural identity. One is the African presence, how to present your past. It is an unseen presence. You can see this in art, you can see this in music, you can see this in painting, but you don't see in a diasporic subject, you don't see it as a visible presence. Then you have the European presence. It is a presence of power. And the third is the New World presence or the American presence, where cultures meet and constantly shape you or constantly shape the cultural subject. Therefore, cultural identity becomes a constant production and reproduction. I'll stop there and I'll take questions if you have any. Thank you.
If you have questions, I can take you on board. Thank you, Dr. Raj, for your brilliant discussion. I hope the students will be immensely enriched by your lecture. But we'd like to hear more from you in future, of course.
Sure, we can.
I'm waiting for somebody. Okay. If you have any question, please join us. Please visit the link I gave you. I pasted there. Please visit the link, then I can take you on board. Bondita Kaur, do you have any question? If you have any question, we can ask. Or if you have any query. Riya Das has a question. Okay, yes. Riya, please join us or just type your question here. Please visit the link to join us. Okay.
Hello, sir.
Yes, hello.
Sir, I'm Riya Dashwapatra, student of PG, last SEM. I have a question.
Yes.
Yes, sir. Sir, my question is that as you say that being and becoming,
yes.
How does it matter for our education or something like that?
If you want to connect this with education,
yes.
If you think education as a process rather than studying for 12 years, then forgetting about what you learn, or think about 2 years that you study and forget about that. If you want to think about education as a process, you constantly evolve. So being and becoming is a process like knowledge. So they are complementary to each other. Your education shapes your being and your becoming.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Any other question?
No, sir, no more.
Okay, Sandeep Das, I'm adding him.
Okay.
Sandeep, hello. Sandeep, put your question. Okay,
hello. Hello.
Yes,
yeah,
Sandeep.
Yeah.
Good morning, sir.
Good morning, Sandeep. Tell me.
Yeah. Sir, I have a question that why yes. Race matters so much for the people.
Now, it is a very subjective thing to hold. Why race matters is a very subjective thing. We all have certain things very close to us. So the idea of race is very subjective. That is what I think. Now, those people who constantly hold this closer to them, or a subjective holding of this race as an idea, can have a very limited boundary, who doesn't actually want to cut across the their own race. But from the point of view of our essay, what I would suggest is that Stuart Hall is talking about is, it is the experience of a particular people or the diaspora rather than the race. He's not terming actually the race or the blacks, but he's actually talking about the experience that is evolving. Now, this has nothing to do with race. Race, that is a very subjective question. And we are actually discussing how experience shapes the cultural identity.
Sir, I listened some YouTube video on and a lecture of Stuart Hall. And okay. And there she it told I heard that that classification of a human,
yes,
classification of a human, most times she used that term. I want to know about the sir, please discuss something classification of a human. Sorry, sir.
So there are two ways of classification. One is the there are many ways of classification. For example, if you go to science, they will have a different way of classifying human beings. Then you go to anthropology itself is a study of human beings. So obviously they have to classify. There should be some kind of a rubric rather than using the word classification. There is some kind of a classification or a rubrics or model under which you you put together human beings. For us, what matters is the classification of or the different ways of looking at people from the point of view of culture. See, I have a culture, you have a culture, which is a very strong culture. We are all cultural people. That is, it is from there cultural identity comes. So to connect your question to cultural identity, the classification of human beings in some way matters, because that is where we will be able to represent ourselves and our culture. I think that is the first point that he says, the position from which a subject speaks. So I cannot speak as you, because you have a completely different cultural experience. I have a completely different cultural experience. See,
yes, sir.
Think about the authors that we read. For example, Shakespeare represents a completely different culture. And I have a different, you know, Indian writing in English have a different culture. See, there we classify. That classification is what matters, rather than classifying people under caste or religion or the other small exclusive forms of classification. For us, for our examination, our research, it is the cultural differences that matters.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Waiting. If you have any question, you can just put that in the comment box, or you can join us live following the link I gave you. I'm waiting for you. We are waiting for you, actually. Very interesting discussion, Dr. Raj, about being and becoming. And the Greek philosophers, right from Pythagoras, they were also concerned with the concept of being and becoming. Actually, they were over-obsessed. Actually, I can say they were obsessed with the concept of being and becoming, philosophically.
Yes.
Okay. Who is... Actually, Greek philosophy grew up following these questions for a long time. And when it comes to our time, we find that these are the questions also important for our time, for our identity.
Yes. I see, please give a brief discussion about being and becoming. I'll tell you, as Dr. Tharun was telling, I'll tell you a few things. I'll substantiate what he told. The whole Western philosophy is built on the concept of being or self. If you read Plato, he talks about two things. One is form and matter. The other obvious example that I can give you is the example of Descartes. Descartes' famous dictum, "I think, therefore I am," is a very good example of how Western philosophy sees being and becoming. When you think, you are a being. Otherwise, you cease to exist. And when you think, you also become. So this is a very, very individual, very, very exclusive way of thinking about being and becoming. Now, when postmodernism came, They were able to break this. They were able to challenge this idea of this exclusive idea of being and becoming. Now, the idea that I can represent your being is very much there in Western thinking. The other example that I can quote is the Orientalism. What is India was represented in Western chronicles by a Westerner, not by an Indian. So the being of an Indian, the becoming of Indian, was actually negotiated by someone who doesn't know who is an Indian. The postmodernism, postcolonial theory, diasporic theory, feminism, these are the theories that actually challenge that if someone can represent someone else's being and becoming. That is what is crucial in Stuart Hall's discussion also. So when you become or you represent being and becoming, then that is where your cultural identity is articulated. That is why we have postcolonial studies. You speak, or your being and becoming is experience. The empire writes back. So you express yourself. You express your cultural identity.
Okay. We have Prabhuti Das. Okay, gone. Please try to reconnect and we'll take you on board. If you have any query or if you want to comment on something. Actually, if we look at some of the concepts of Greek philosophy, we find that the philosophers were more concerned with interpreting the world, matter by matter, I mean physical matter, and they were trying to incorporate the ideas or transfer the ideas from the physical world to the world of human activities. If we check the concept of Kalu Kagat here, then we can find, or if we check the views of Pythagoras on mathematical calculations, mathematical representation, then we can find that they were trying to impose something formulaic on the human behavior, on human society. And I do not say that problem started right there, but I can say that since the Western cultural heritage drew much from the Greek tradition, these things remain there, even if in dormant form, if not yes. as a dominant form. Okay, Prabhuti Das is live. I am taking her on board. If okay.
Good morning, yes. sir.
Good morning.
Yeah. I have heard all these, as you told now, that you were talking about post-structuralism, which is there in his text, I mean, in Stuart Hall's The Culture and Cultural Identity and Diaspora. I want to know one more thing, sir, that is not this, that cultural identity, it's always within us, like us, who are truly Indian. It means truly Indian, that in a quoted form of Indian, that we are not coming from the diasporic background, right? But we are all, can it not happen? Is it not happening that every single time we are facing the problem of cultural identity, the difference between who, as you were telling, that someone who is your neighbor, he has a different cultural identity. So is it not the matter that every time in our life we are facing some problem, which is the matter of the difference within our identity, obviously that cultural identity, but is it not the matter that it's diasporic or not, but every time we are facing the same thing, like I mean, have you got it?
Yes okay. I want to start by saying that India is an exception in this world. That is why we are called subcontinent. We are so much syncretic. We are like a matrix. We already have hundreds of cultures, and the mobility after 1947 has made it very difficult for us to have a stable cultural identity, or for that matter, for a collective self, for that matter. Now, making it more complex is the intersection of cultures from elsewhere, that is the Western cultures, the that which comes now. How am I present myself as an individual subject with having a unique cultural identity? I don't know if I can say this. I don't know if it is ever possible, because there is so much of assimilation that has happened. That is, assimilation is actually a theory that comes in multiculturalism. We have assimilated so much of cultures from other culture, language. See, we, you know, for me, I cannot talk Tamil without using a few English words. No, if you are talking about language and cultural identity, there itself the cultural identity is gone. If I am a true Indian, then I should be speaking my mother tongue, which is almost not possible for the kids that are born after 1980s, especially 1980s or 1970s. We all are, you know, obsessed somewhere here. Our being has become so, you know, very much assimilated with other cultures. So it is very difficult. Maybe this is a specter that we are chasing, or that this is an illusion that we are chasing, to have a pure, pristine cultural identity. I think that is where Stuart Hall is important, because we should acknowledge that our presence, the presence, that the new world presence is within us. Though we have our indigenous presence, though we have the post-colonial presence, we should also acknowledge the fact that we are the products of the new world. So it is actually very syncretic. He uses the term there in the essay. So our identity, to have a very pure identity, I don't know. It is
Identity can't be like holiness, full of holiness, or the purity. It's something which is ever changing, is not it, sir?
Yes. It is a process. It is something that is very important that he says is this cultural identity constantly comes from within. It is shaped from within. That is where being and becoming begins. Our being is constantly bombarded with these cultures. So it is very, very hard for us to have a very very pure cultural identity or a cultural tag that we can carry.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Professor,
do you want to say anything? Okay, I just cut it off.
No, it's okay. I have talked too much.
Okay. If you have any more questions, please let us know. We are waiting. So we'll wait for a few minutes, then we'll conclude the session. You can post your queries or questions as comments, okay? If you do not want to go live, or if your device is not supporting going live, accessing the stream mode, or if you are on low bandwidth, you can just post your comment, and Dr. Raj will surely try to answer your queries. Okay, we have another user. We have Thakur Das Jana, a guest faculty of our college. He has some queries. Thakur Das.
Good morning, sir.
Morning.
Yes.
Morning.
Yes. Good morning, sir. It's a great pleasure to, listen to you in this, condition where we are almost locked down at home.
Yes.
Okay. So my question is that in this, at the present time, almost as we can't go out of home, we are depending on technology.
Yes.
And is there any connection between the uses of different digital technology specifically and different kind of social medias? So, these social medias or the digital technologies, is there a connection between this one and the formation of one kind of cultural identity? That we find that specifically the people who are very much, comfortable using this kind of digital technologies, so we form one kind of identity, rather, different from the people who can't use, or, the technologies which are not available to the other people. So is there any connection or the link between these two things?
There are a few things that come to my mind. One, there is a psychological connection. there is a discipline that we call cultural psychology. Certainly, they will be able to talk more about the link between technology and culture. I will give you a few examples. One, we are not able to put down our mobile phones. Two, I read an article telling that if you follow the Facebook post of a person for 15 or 20 days, you will be able to think about who that person is, what that person is thinking about. It is what the being of a person, at least 30 to 40% is you will be able to collect. Now, this means that there is a huge, for those who use technology, there is a huge effect. The culture and technology go hand in hand in that particular aspect. On the other hand, those people who do not use this technology, for maybe our parents or our grandparents, they would never know how to use technology. They actually preserve they are a repository of culture that they carry, but they also are evolving constantly from their aspect. For example, even if they are not using social media, they are seeing TV, or they are getting the news through paper. So these are the things that actually influences them also. So there is a link between culture and technology, and how culture and technology influences a being in 21st century, I think it is inevitable. So when you talk of cultural identity, it almost becomes inevitably important for you to speak about media, at least for our millennials. It is inevitably important for us to look how these media and how all these technology impact. Let us take this to another level. Technology in the kitchen. Why only talk about technology in social media? See, technology in kitchen has altered completely our culture. We have easy way of cooking. We have instant noodles, instant coffee. Yeah, earlier we have to depend on coffee seeds. They make, I have seen my grandfather's collecting coffee seeds, then the drying it, powdering it. See, technology has almost permeated into every aspect. And when we talk about technology, it is very, 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 very important that we associate it with culture. And I think Tarun is doing a great job in promoting the digital humanities. And he'll be talking to you more on digital humanities.
My perception is that for some decades, two or three, we have been under the impact of globalization, a kind of magical impact of globalization and consumerism, of course, an extension of globalization and market economy. Now, after the corona, in the post-corona period, we'll understand that technology matters as far as it is concerned with our practical usage. If it does not have any practical use, then we need to go back to our roots.
Yes. Okay.
Going back to the roots will be one of the things we will see in the post-corona period. Now, using technology sometimes is a matter of fashion, and if it is a matter of fashion, then it is more concerned with the question of identity. For instance, possessing an iPhone gives you a kind of identity. Now, this may be personal conception of the user, or maybe a conception of some of the viewers as well, or the members of the society. Finally, we will understand that we will use the things which are necessary, which we will try to discard the things which are unnecessary. For instance, I take this example to our academia. Now, if we look at our syllabi, other questions in NET, SET, etc. Or if we visit the bookstores or library, we'll find bookshelves now filled with so many books by so many authors, so many theories. Theories are coming and coming. That type of thing, a heavy, a kind of heady rush of theories we had after the Second World War, till 2000, for 50 years, we have had a heavy rush of theories. Now, the question is, do we need all the theories? Do we need? We may not need all the theories, because when we are obsessed with theories, we are paying less attention to the creative works. We are reading less and less critical works, and we are reading more and more critical works, because they are also concerned with our profession,
yes,
professional identity. Okay, so knowing the critics, knowing the theories becomes a matter of a personal identity. So these things are interconnected, complicated, and I think during the post-corona days, or during the period of lockdown, people are thinking, intellectuals are thinking what to do after. So we'll have a fresh period, I hope we'll have a fresh period after the lockdown period. So many creative things will come out.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Anybody, do you have any question? Any other viewers, do you have any question? If you do not have any question, then we'll conclude the session. I am grateful and thankful to Dr. Raj for coming over the screen and delivering the lecture for our students. Our students are also thankful and grateful to you. And we all, our teachers, our students, our principal, our college in totality, will be looking forward to more of your lectures in future.
Thank you. Thank you, Tarun, for having me.
Thank you. I'm ending the session, and we'll reschedule some program later on in future. Surely we'll do something.
Thank you. Bye.
Thank you. Thank you. Have a good day.
You too.